So 2 days ago, 2 days ago, we announced the Mont Pelerin Protocol. We believe this is quite unique and historical, and for one reason. Because we look at the whole lifetime value of this token. And what this framework brings is a way to create any type of security token, any type of asset-backed token, any type of pretty much anything that has a real counterparty in real life, and yet be compliant with pretty much any jurisdiction. Of course, for Switzerland, we have pre-designed several type of tokens, such as the fiat token that has all the rules to make it working with the Swiss regulator. The security tokens such as share token, debt token, loans, etc., and as well as derivatives. As well, we have a framework for the transferability, etc., etc. And then you can expand this use case to any other things. And today, what we're building here is this basically very flexible framework. But we want to prove it. We don't want just to say, well, this is the best security token platform issuance whatsoever. No, I mean, this is not what we intend to do in the first place. So this is the base, this is the root for the future bank we're building to tokenize its entire balance sheet. Yeah. So this is very important for us that since day one, it is fully compliant and fully parametric, that we can trigger all the parameters to make sure it works just like the regulator would like it to work. Yeah. So we will prove, and we will prove by selling the first share token ever, which is the Mont Pelerin token, the MPL token, that will represent the share of the future company. And this is quite historical because for the first time, we're not selling a voucher for share. We're not selling any type of utility token plus some kind of profit sharing or revenue sharing or whatsoever. We're really selling you shares. That means that you will be protected by law and not by a simple contract between a company and an individual. You will be protected by law as a shareholder. And again, on our side, the way we made this token to be compliant is that we had to make some restrictions. We had to put some conditions around the fact that you become shareholders. So today, this token will be freely transferable without having to have a set of whitelists. But in order to become a shareholder, you will need first to own the token, but then you need also to pass the KYC. And that will grant you the two privileges that are attached to the fact that you own the share, which is the social right, being able to vote, and the economical right, being able to receive a dividend. There is also one thing that is important to note is that we are open sourcing everything. Yeah, so it's already there. Anyone can download it, use it, can fork it, can contribute. It's fully open source. Anyone that wants to issue their own security token, their own shares on chain, well, it's all there. But of course, there is as well the compliance aspect and the legal aspect, because you cannot go and sell shares to the crowd without a proper prospectus, without a proper terms of sales, and to explain to people exactly what they are buying into, right? So that's also why we're going to open source all our legal documents, so that the next people coming to do it, they can just copy paste what we've done, change some numbers that are in line with what they intend to do, change your name, and just not even changing a single rule, being able to issue a new share token. And that, I think, is quite an advance today, because you don't need to pay 100K this lawyer to make this and that. You will just be able to copy paste what we've already done. Again, this is the first use case, the share, but this framework is unlimited. Yeah. So by just changing the rules, by changing the order of the rules, changing what you apply, etc., you can look at issuing pretty much any type of instrument. So today, what we've done is flexible enough to comply with any type of regulations. Of course, today we don't know how it works outside of Switzerland and EU that we know well. So that would be for you, up to you, if you are in the US, to do it, to make sure you have a good lawyer that makes all the documents, the legal documents that comes along with it, and that you maybe reshape this token so that it fits this requirement. But on our side, at least what we can do is that for Switzerland, we know it works, so you can just copy paste and use it. So let me compare maybe quickly the Mont Pelerin protocol with Polymath, for example. Polymath is a good example of what has been done up to now by pretty much several competitors. Most of those guys, they were really focusing on one thing, which is the issuance. Yeah, how can I issue and sell securities on chain? How can I make sure that it is compliant? And what you saw is that, for example, companies like Polymath, I think it's a very good example, they created a kind of platform, or they're at least working on creating a kind of platform where people can use already made smart contracts to issue those security tokens. And then they want to put on the same platform some lawyer, so that for everything you want to do, you can contact this lawyer, you will pay the bill directly to him, he will help you, you know, produce all the legal documents that comes along with it, etc. You can have different actors on their platform. But the fact is that on their side, the way they look at it is that we are just the IT provider. And you can even see that by the way they finance themselves. So they issued a utility token. So they are claiming to be like the security token guys, but yet they didn't apply it to themselves first. Yeah. So they said, yeah, we are issuing a utility token. And yet, if you want to issue a security, it's unproven. And then the second aspect that we are missing here is the lifetime value of this token. Because again, it's not about the issuance only. Yeah? It's not about selling it at the first stage. It's not about the primary market. But it's as well the point of the lifetime value. Yeah? And if you, the only way you make it compliant is by having a set of whitelist, yeah, restricted to only people that have passed the KYC, and that's it, it makes it less appealing. Of course, sometimes you don't have any other option. Yeah, that's by law what you have to do, but sometimes you don't. Sometimes you can find other ways. And that's pretty much what we believe on our side, is that by having a more refined way to put conditions and restrictions on transferability, we can achieve something way more powerful. Yeah, by having tokens that represent such a security, a share, or anything, and where you can activate some rights by passing the KYC, meaning that you can still have the transferability quite free up until certain amounts, etc. So you can define any type of rules, but at least you can define a very much, very well, better refined type of a framework and have something that is a lot more appealing, and also something that is evolutive over time in order to fit new evolutions of the regulators, the legal aspect of it. So, while many other companies focusing on bringing securities on chain are really focusing on the IT side of it, on the IT aspect of it, we are focusing on the full scope. And today we have, of course, a working IT prototype. We are testing it in real life with banks. It's still at the stage of proof of concept, still. But we intend, and our ambition, of course, is to become the bank and offer to become the one-stop shop for anyone in the world to issue those tokens in a compliant way, because they would delegate it to us. The idea is that as a bank, we have the infrastructure to issue those tokens for them, but as well as all the legal requirements that comes along with it, and of course ensure the lifetime compliancy of this token, and to facilitate and to be the arrangeur, basically, of those transactions for anyone, even the pizzeria, even the hairdresser, anyone that is not sophisticated enough, obviously, to do that on its own.